Love will tear us apart. Again.
It was easier once I decided to kill him. But I still have to be careful. One slip and I'm dead. It's him or me, so it has to be him. I almost bumped into creepy neighbour in the garden path. It's a lovely night for a cornetto, he says. Is he offering me an ice cream or just making an observation? Trying to sound interesting? Perhaps he has wind of my artwork. He looks impotent, not up to rape. Ever since catching pneumonia on the night flight back from Havana, I haven't been hearing right. The other day I was asked outside a gym if I'd like to save £200. I thought the woman was asking, would you like to visit a gentleman's room? Depends which gentleman, I replied, confusing her. Hearing is an important part of your equipment, but deafness has its advantages. Marilyn's pain can so easily become Marilyn melting in the rain. Creepy neighbour looks at me, soliciting a response. I smile without replying. I don't like fake Italian ice cream anyway. My clean, white home waits for me like heaven. Apart from the evil big blue bottle buzzing around, settling first on my white leather sofa, then on my marble dining table. How did this ugly thing even get in here? I reach for the can of CS gas in my pocket, blinding myself without harming the giant fly. The thing dances around me, gloating as I choke. Insects and humans have different nervous systems. Mr. Novak, the paedophile teacher, taught us that. Be careful you don't choke to death, Creepy says, when I run coughing into the garden. He's the kind of guy who could be damaged with a squirt of fly spray, but his insides would be immune to anti-rape gas. He leans against my palm tree, staring at my cleavage. To be fair, my chest is eye level for him. He'd have to stand on tiptoe to look me in the face. Nice night for it, Creepy says, smirking. For what? Raping your neighbour? Familiarity is a false protection. Someone familiar, especially someone creepy, wouldn't pick me as a target because everyone would know he did it. Statistically, I'm wrong. Most victims are murdered, raped and violated by people they know. Sometimes the murderer doesn't mind being caught. For Creepy Neighbour, the game would be to kill the bitch from number 13, have everyone in the building suspect, but get away with it. No Raskolnikov confessions from Creepy, no guilt, no mistakes. My only defence is a can of doom now in my bag to replace the CS gas squandered on the fly. Also in my bag is a record of Creepy's activities. Elvis is still saving CCTV evidence for me. I didn't bother explaining that Creepy is no longer my installation. That show is dusted. I have the dress picked out already for my opening night. Now I'm climbing the ladder to Hollywood, amazed by my overnight success. Who needs experience when you have ideas and a successful director on board? The Oscar's practically in the bag. It's easier to take the evidence from Elvis and continue playing the Dick's Ink game until I leave town. But the creepy show bores me now. He goes in and out of his flat carrying large bin bags. It may have been more interesting to conceal a camera in the bin room, find out what he gets up to in there after dark. My nose draws the line at putting on a pair of rubber gloves and examining his rubbish. My phone is ringing my bag as I slam the door in Creepy's face and walk back into my own white heaven. The landline's ringing too. Which one will I answer? I don't look weak, indecisive. People say I have intelligent eyes. I appear to know what I'm doing. I stand staring at the phones, wondering which one is you and which one is him. James could be calling to say when he's coming home. You could be calling to say you love me. First you have to know what you want, and then you have to take it. I have to kill him when he gets home. I'll write it down, make it real. But first I have to answer the phones. Or just leave them ringing. It's you, all business, inviting me to discuss locations for spying on strange men. It's a business meeting, not a date. A lunch, not a dinner. You have your pride. You're not going to throw yourself at me. I'm half listening to your voice as I tug at the wedding ring, deforming my finger. It's easier to take off than put back on. Forcing it back in my finger, covering the bruise I made pulling off. I don't want to send him a signal, give him a clue what I'm up to. We make a date or an appointment, depending on the mood. We need an end to our story, or a beginning. The hate triangle in the middle is starting to bore me. Time's almost up. James is almost home. I'm ready. And then the world blows up.